What if the NRL that we know and love never formed? How about a world where not one, but two rugby league competitions fought to establish themselves as the premier product? This may seem like some sort of utopia, the more footy the better, right? Well, this two competition situation was a reality not too long ago, and I promise you, it was no utopia. Let's talk about the scandal, greed, and the fallout of the Super League war, and how it almost killed the sport that we love so much today. Starting in 1990, Kerry Packer, the owner of both Channel 9 and Optus Vision, would buy the rights off Channel 10 for $24 million, with 10 later going into receivership. This would save the Australian Rugby League for the time being, and in 1993, ARL TV rights would be up for sale once again. Rugby League's recent major growth meant that this sport would be the crown jewel for any TV corporation willing to pay enough. It would be between both Kerry Packer's Nine Corporation and Rupert Murdoch's News Limited as they would battle for the right of Australia's most prized TV possession. It would be ultimately Packer's Nine Corporation who won, agreeing to a 7-year, $70 million deal with the ARL, which would take the sport into 2000. This was devastating news to News Limited as they had given up a huge advantage to its direct competitor. These matters were resolved for the time being, but it would be an understatement to say that there was some discontent within the game. Low player wages, club favouritism by the ARL, and a concern that the pure fabric of rugby league was being removed by the ARL were all concerns which brings us into our next chapter. The aim of John Rubo's Super League was to create an elite 12-team competition with the help of Rupert Murdoch and News Limited. They also planned to construct a World Club Series with teams from Australia, New Zealand and Great Britain. Their main goal was to completely wipe the ARL and to make the Super League the sole competition. The peak of the Super League war that some of you may be familiar with occurred during 1996, but murmurs of disgruntled club chairmen can be traced back to the prior year of 1993, directly after Nine sealed their TV rights deal. John Rebo, the Brisbane Broncos chairman, believed that grand finals should be played at the newly developed Suncorp Stadium, with it able to hold up to 20,000 more patrons than the Sydney Football Stadium. This request was swiftly knocked back by the New South Wales Rugby League, as they also sacked him from the Premiership Policy Committee board. Rubo became tired of Rugby League's Sydney-centric attitude, especially after the Broncos had just won their second New South Wales Rugby League Premiership. Although the Sydney first attitude may have been true, it was no secret that the Broncos had advantages like having a monopoly over the sponsorship dollars in Brisbane, weekly nationally televised games, and the luxury of the first pick of the entirety of the Queensland talent pool. Despite this, Rubo was still not content with how the Broncos were treated within rugby league. He would then start discussions in May of 1994 with News Limited about a hypothetical new competition with higher salaries under the name the Super League. To try to ensure this outcome, the Super League approached four clubs, with this being Brisbane, Canberra, Newcastle and Auckland. These clubs were pinpointed as key to the takeover. The next step of the proposal was to meet with the ARL and offer them rights and ownership to international tests, matches and allow them to keep the profits to those games. They then met with the 11 Sydney clubs in Illawarra, who they planned to disband and offer them the opportunity to have a share in a club that would participate in the Super League. It acknowledged that many teams and players would be upset with the deal and just planned to compensate these stakeholders to reduce friction. These proposed steps were very bullish. And as many of you may have expected, it did not go down well with the Sydney clubs who were asked to disband. At this point, this was still a planned proposal by the Super League and was yet to be put forward, but these plans had become common knowledge. The ARL wanted to squash these plans by sending out a warning stating, "The league has the right to deny admission to any team into the Winfield Cup, and that the Brisbane Broncos may face expulsion over their involvement with the Super League." Tensions were high and the ARL acted quickly, demanding each ARL club sign loyalty agreements to keep them within the competition. ARL chairman Ken Arthurson would then organise a meeting with News Limited representative Paul Cowley, who stated that the Super League would make a 12-team competition with or without the ARL, which involved taking a portion of the ARL's TV revenue. Arthurson strongly snubbed this idea and basically challenged the Super League, saying, "We've got all the players tied up and all the clubs tied up. It's pretty difficult to start another competition." The four clubs in Brisbane, Canberra, Newcastle and Auckland that the Super League planned to take with them also didn't go according to plan. The Brisbane Broncos in particular were threatened with expulsion over significant involvement in the Super League. These threats, combined with a 5-year loyalty contract that each ARL club president signed, meant that the Super League was kept at bay, at least for the meantime. Arthurson was insistent on keeping rugby league under the ARL's rule, saying that the control of the game was non-negotiable. This did not stop News Limited though, who doubled down on their plans, adapting their proposal. On the 22nd of December, 1995, Brisbane, Canberra, Newcastle, Cronulla and the Western Reds were given a document titled the Confidentiality Deed. This was to get the clubs to input on what adjustments needed to be made before the Super League planned a full proposal for late January. They would eventually include Auckland, Cronulla, Illawarra and St George into discussions. It is alleged that clubs were offered $2.5 million annually in the new plan, which with inflation would be worth $4.4 million in today's value. These sums were not disclosed by News Limited, and the exact amounts were denied. To put into context, players were making no more than $15,000 in the mid-90s, so these funds would be huge, which made the proposal even more enticing. It was also rumoured that the Super League would supply the ARL $3 million annually if they were to accept the terms and allow the Super League to run Australia's first grade rugby league competition. These figures were not confirmed though, and it was the 30th of January when News Limited would bring forward their final proposal to the ARL. To summarise, News Limited wanted to drastically cut down the league, add teams in bigger markets, and provide huge financial support to the sport. ARL claimed the proposal was totally unacceptable. The ARL itself was planning to cull 6 teams for the 1995 season, but because of the new deal between the ARL and Kerry Packers 9 for TV rights, this was avoided. Ken Arthurson would meet yet again with the ARL clubs to give them certainty about the future of the sport. All but 5 teams that signed the confidentiality agreement with News Limited were committed to the ARL. Those 5 teams were still discontent with the ARL, but were again reminded that they had signed loyalty agreements, with the ARL going a step further, faxing every club a deed, which basically was a test of loyalty, with the deed reading, "The league will view the failure of any club to sign and return the deed by the deadline as an act of gross disloyalty. I also refer you to yesterday's meeting of the league, which passed a resolution to recommend that the board of the league consider the expulsion of any club which fails to sign and return this deed by the deadline." This decision by the ARL was interpreted as divisive, and in later litigation ruled a breach of the Trade Practices Act. It was clear that tensions were rising, and this situation was becoming serious as dirty politics and greed were starting to tarnish the greatest game of all. Now, a quick transition to our swag sponsor, Manscaped. Ho ho, gentlemen, the holidays have come early this year as Manscaped have the gift that keeps on trimming. Santa's beard isn't so appealing when it's coming out of your trousers. Ooh! And that's why Manscaped, the leaders in below-the-waist grooming, have you covered this holiday season. Now available in your country, join the 4 million men worldwide who trust Manscaped to keep their trees trimmed and ornaments polished. Go to manscaped.com and use code ALPHAKAI for 20% off plus free shipping. It's jingle balls to the walls season, fellas, with Manscaped Performance Package 4.0. You'll find the signature lawnmower 4.0. This electric trimmer has proprietary advanced skin safe technology to reduce cuts to your nuts. That means less fooey-fooey moi-moi and more Alfie Langer downstairs, if you know what I'm talking about. I mean, look how shiny that head is. Tis the season to load up on Manscaped products, so go get yourself, your dad, your brother, your mates, the freshest gift to exist, which is the Manscaped Performance Package 4.0. Again, get 20% off and free shipping with the code ALPHAKAI at manscaped.com. That's 20% off with free shipping at manscaped.com and use code ALPHAKAI. Clean up your nuts and make Santa proud this year. Now, let's get back into the video. The Super League had realised that their democratic efforts were getting them nowhere and shifted their approach. Let's call this the rebel approach. No longer were Super League officials like Cowley and Ribbo talking to the ARL, but they were now just targeting the players. Understanding that there was no way that the ARL wanted to collaborate, News Limited had identified a weakness in the ARL's competition, which was the high concentration of teams in Sydney. With 11 clubs in Sydney, for the most part struggling financially during the time, the threat of a takeover continued to loom over the ARL. In mid-March of 1995, Cowley and Arthurson would meet once more, with Cowley assuring that all future approaches would go through the ARL and no longer through the individual clubs. The discussion was quite constructive, but it would not be long before Arthurson would get intel that teams were indeed still talking to Super League representatives, which of course violated their loyalty agreements. The Super League knew that their past attempts of making this rebel league had failed for a variety of reasons. Rupert Murdoch stated that they assumed the threat alone of an alternative competition would cause the ARL to fold. They were also in a spot where some clubs did not take the Super League approach seriously, as they had already failed multiple times. The Super League's more aggressive new approach looked like this. The key elements of this more aggressive approach were to sign up all the players required for a 10-team Australian competition at approximately twice their current earnings, mount a challenge to the 5-year agreement binding the clubs, credibly mount a rival Super League without the ARL establishment, even though the best outcome was for the ARL to cooperate. Murdoch and the Super League were ready to stop at nothing to get their way. 200 ARL players were targeted as Super League representatives got to work flying across Australia and New Zealand under fake names in order to keep secrecy, as they knew the ARL would strongly disapprove of their actions. The Super League acted quickly and on 6th of April 1995 had signed deals with both the United Kingdom, France, Pacific Islands and New Zealand Rugby League federations as international test matches were conducted through these nations. This meant that Murdoch had essentially alienated the Australian Kangaroos out of international play and those countries' youngsters. The Super League's next step was to sign players. A total of 307 players and 10 coaches were signed. And out of those 307 players, 200 of them were still signed to the ARL past the following 1996 season. These players were signed for approximately double their current earnings with the Super League, and the expectation of 10-team league was to be made. As players were flip-flopping between the ARL and Super League, as entire clubs, players, their agents and staff were just out to get their best deal for themselves. Loyalty was a thing of the past, and at this point it was safe to say there was no longer any moral high ground as the sport became a free-for-all. Whilst all this drama and player movement was happening, during 1996 the future of rugby league was being determined in the courts. Both Packer and Murdoch went at each other's necks, and in the courts this process was one that was long and drawn out. Early on in the court proceedings it looked like the Super League was dead and buried. On September 1995, the ARL would start the case to prevent the creation of the Super League. This battle would continue till March of 1996, with the judge stating that Murdoch and News Limited acted with dishonesty and duplicity, banning the Super League's start in 1996. Rupert Murdoch was quoted saying that this court decision was just 1-0 at half-time. Clubs that strongly favoured the Super League in 1996 were forced to forfeit their round one games as punishment, but the ARL continued to keep control of rugby league during the 1996 season. With the Super League's previous failures to combine with the ARL or create its own league, their hopes seemed dead in the water. This was the case until an appeal of the previous decision was made by the Super League, in which the tables would turn. In a shocking turn of events, the previous decision of no Super League was overturned, with this essentially clearing the way for the Super League Telstra Cup to commence in 1997. ARL chairman Ken Arthurson was quoted after the defeat saying, "I was furious, hurt, bewildered. I felt as if I'd been run over by the Southern Aurora." The ARL would try to appeal this decision but were denied, forcing Arthurson to resign, and the Super League was now all systems go. The game was now divided, with the two separate competitions looking like this. It's safe to say that this split did not benefit either side. Rivalries between clubs were broken, as fans had to choose between either paying for Optus or Foxtel to watch their beloved sides. The sport had been struck by greed and the fans could sense it. In one season, players had gone from being part-time bricklayers that fans could relate to ultra-wealthy megastars. There were too many teams and games to watch and the gimmicks began to run thin, as fans tuned out. Tickets from both competitions were being given away, and this was just seasons removed from rugby league having record crowds. Outside of the historic ARL Grand Final between the Knights and Manly and the dominant Broncos side of the Super League, there wasn't too much to note from that year. The 1990 season was a failure for both competitions, as hundreds of millions had been lost in revenue, and the current two-competition model was unsustainable. Both Packer and Murdoch would come to a peace agreement, both taking a 50% stake of a combined competition. Clubs would fall by the wayside after a 14-team competition would be agreed upon. The Western Reds, Gold Coast Chargers, Adelaide Rams, Hunter Mariners and North Sydney Bears fell victim to this decision. We also saw the merging of Western Suburbs and Balmain, Manly in North Sydney and Illawarra and St George. This new collaborative league wasn't pretty, but it was essential financially for rugby league. Within this huge mess, the winners were the player agents and players, who went from part-time tradies to multi-millionaires in a year. The contracts were so exorbitant at the time that they even rival what we see today. The winner between the ARL and News Limited, I'd say, was News, who did get the rights to the NRL and now had 50% of the competition. It did come at a huge cost financially though, with approximately $560 million spent over the 8-year process. It also set back the game in terms of international play and junior competitions. Although tumultuous at the time, rugby league has become a more financially responsible sport that reached a level of professionalism because of the Super League War. Although in some ways beneficial to rugby league, at its core, the Super League War was nothing more than just two wealthy business moguls' greed, which unfortunately seeped into our great game. Hi guys, hope you enjoyed this piece on the Super League War. This involved a lot of script writing and editing, so hit that like button and subscribe for more if you enjoyed this content. Check out the Alpha socials and Patreon if you do want to support this channel. And as always, thank you guys for watching.